y por casualidad duerme y sueña que te acaricia la brisa y sientes que el rocío mañanero besa tiernamente tus mejillas y el aroma del café te hace cosquillas. Seguro sueñas que estás en Puerto Rico y por casualidad duermes y sueñas que te enamoran las olas y que hay un cielo azul que conjura con la luna para hacerte prisionero. No lo digo porque es la tierra que quiero. Seguro sueñas que estás en Puerto Rico. Yo no puedo ocultar el orgullo que siento de ser puertorriqueño y que mi pensamiento, no importa dónde voy, se fuga hacia la islita, no importa dónde voy.
Bienvenides. Good evening, everybody. Welcome, everybody, to this celebration of Graciano's life. Today, October 18th, would have been Graciano's birthday. We were listening to one of his favorite danzas, Felices Días, and then we listened to Dreaming in Puerto Rico, Soñando con Puerto Rico, which was one of his favorite songs. And for many of us who were listening to it, it gets us emotional. We are so pleased that we have come together tonight to celebrate the life and work of our beloved colleague and friend, Graciano Matos Santiago. Graciano was a very proud Puerto Rican, born on precisely a day like today in Naranjito, Puerto Rico, a beautiful town in the mountain area of the island. He was the proud son of Graciano Matos and Luz Belén Santiago. We lost Graciano this past summer, but his passion and fierce spirit of fighting for liberation and struggling against oppression lives goes on. Graciano served passionately and proudly on our anti-bullying initiatives that he both led and participated in. And he was a determined and fierce anti-bullying advocate who never hesitated to advocate against bullying. Graciano was committed to achieve an effective CUNY anti-bullying policy. He was committed to fight for changes in grievance procedures and to get into the contract language, whatever will ensure us as PSC members to feel supported and fairly represented with empathy and conviction. Tonight, we will share with all of you a pre-recorded presentation on workplace bullying, as well as Graciano's bullying story. We will also feature personal sharings of Graciano's relatives and colleagues, illustrating how his contributions will continue to ripple through our scholar and union work. We will also want to highlight that because of Graciano's constant advocacy for better services for our union members, addressing bullying in our workplace, and his fight for liberation and justice within CUNY and in his Puerto Rican community, our anti-bullying committee presented a resolution to the Delegate Assembly of the PSC this past September, honoring Graciano and declaring that every year the PSC would celebrate freedom from workplace bullies, Week. And this year, which marks the first one that we have ever celebrated that, we are officially celebrating this week, which starts today. We are celebrating Graciano, precisely on what would have been, and I repeat again, his birthday. So now I will ask my dear colleague, Jeanette Batiste, who is a member of the Anti-Bullying Committee and our PSC CLT chairperson, to take care of the next part of our program. Jeanette.
Thank you, Lisa, and welcome everyone to be here and sharing this beautiful day, this awesome time with Graciano and his family and all of you. We thank you so much. I also want to, that we're celebrating his life, that he contributed. He fought, he fought with bullying on the workplace nonstop. His heart was bigger than we could, any of us could imagine. As a person he was. You will be able to watch Graciano in action, talking from his heart, from the deep of his heart. You will see the pain that he experienced through bullying. And I would like for all of you to really take, please listen very carefully to the presentation and take it in heart, because you're gonna see his pain through it. However, we stand together and we fight together against bullying as one person, all of us together. And we will honor him and honor all those that have been bullied as well. He had a powerful personality when it came to taking care of the people that were hurting. And that's one of the reasons also that I decided to be part of the Anti-Bullying Committee. So with no hesitation, please, let's stand together, fight together, stand up for one another. And Jorge, please, can you kindly put in the presentation? Thank you so much.
A silent epidemic, because, I call this the workplace bullying a silent epidemic, because it has an effect and an impact on so many people, you know, and yet not so many people know about it unless you actually sit down and talk about work relations and things like that. Nobody knows about it. And, you know, as I'll mention later on, management does not this really doesn't give a crap about it. Excuse the language, you know. So I would like to start off with some definitions. So, all right. So bullying is a sometimes repetitive, sometimes it's concealed harassment, and it's usually it goes on over time. You mistreat people, you know, you mistreat the individual, maybe more than one individual involved. And the Workplace Bullying Institute defines it as repeated health-harming mistreatment of one or more persons. And these are the target, the person that gets bullied. We don't call it victims, we call them targets. All right, so you can go to the next one. And the perpetrator, they are the bullies. They select the individuals and bully them. And they do so because they, according to their perspective, they have the power to do so. And the targets are usually chosen by the bully to be harassed and abused. And they're selected. They're usually competent people. They don't get into office politics. They're cooperative, ethical, and honest with a positive attitude. So this is a definition by Gary and Ruth Namey. They wrote a book on bullying, and they've written a number of articles that I've looked into. And but in the articles and books that I've read, they agree with Dr. Gary and Ruth Namey. The targets are usually, you know, nice people. The bully feels that they can get away with it, okay, because they're quiet, cooperative, etc. And then you have mobs, right? It's a group of individuals who join in the bullying, in the abuse of the targets, because they are either coerced by the manager or by the bully, whoever it is, the supervisor, or they do it voluntarily, thinking that they can get ahead, you know, later on. And so you have something called microaggressions. It's a new term that has been coined as of lately. And it's usually actions or comments that subtly express a prejudice or an attitude or something, you know, that's not positive towards the person. And the end is a kind of comments that you leave and you say, was that directed to me? Did this person really say that? You know, these are microaggressions. But when you have it over a repeated time frame, it begins to have an impact on the target, you know, psychologically and physically, okay? Because you're really not always prepared to answer back, right? So next one, next slide. Okay, so anyway, I wanted to do those definitions before we start so we're clear as to what we're talking about. So anyway, I came to the U.S., you know, so many years ago, and I worked many odd jobs, you know, printing and printing shops, bookbinding, dishwashing, and construction, painting windows up there in a scaffold. And, you know, I remember particular instance that I called. I had this supervisor. Any little thing, or he would just go by and say, "You stupid spick, you dirty Puerto Rican," you know, and all that kind of stuff. That today, you know, these days, you know, they don't say that openly. They may think it. They may act. But they don't say it openly. Anyway, when my first son was born, I decided to go out and do a bachelor's degree, thinking that, you know, once I did my bachelor's and I gotta, you know, move out of the blue collar, you know, system, I would be doing much better. So next slide. Yeah. So anyway, I was looking forward to, as a professional, you know, things would be better. My first professional job was at Mount Sinai Medical Center. It was the occupational health and safety clinic. They're supposed to cater to working people, etc., right? It was the greatest disappointment in my life. You know, I worked with this lady. You know, she was a nut from hell. You know, I think that if God and the devil exist, she was sent by the devil. And it was somebody, there's an author, right? This guy, Robert I. Sutton, he had a PhD in psychology. He wrote a book, The No Asshole Rule. And this book helps managers and supervisors to purge out during the interview process, purge out, you know, people who are real jerks, and they're going to become bullies in the workplace. So anyway, this lady is somebody that I would call, according to the description, a real big asshole. All right?
that's your professional attribute.
Assessment.
Right? Well, this is...
Assessment.
This guy, PhD, is in psychology. He was the one who coined that term.
Oh, cool.
All right? So I'm just saying that he would call him that asshole also. So next one. Next slide. Yeah. So, you know, to give you an example, the first day I was hired, and the first day I went and stood by her office. She was doing something else. The phone rings a few times, you know, and she comes up and said, "The least you can do is pick up the phone." I mean, I was just there for the first time. I had never entered Mount Sinai in my life, you know? So from there on, it was hell on earth. You know, nothing I did was good. He was overcritical about everything. Next slide. Next slide. Oh, she criticized, you know, she used sarcasm and laughter, and she was very sardonic. She shake her head in silence, you know, any little thing that I did, or whether it was good or bad, you know, she would shake her head in disapproval. When she remained quiet, you know, you have to be careful with her, because she would make this ugly face of disgust. I mean, it was so disgusted that she would look disgusting herself, you know. She shrugged her shoulders. I mean, she did awful evaluations. When I go like this, you next slide. And sometimes she would mumble things. She would mumble things, you know. I could hardly hear, and I couldn't answer either, you know. I mean, it was a situation where she was the supervisor. I was working for her, so it was hard for me to answer anyway. But I didn't have an opportunity, you know, to say anything. She did the same thing that that guy I described early on, you know, dirty Puerto Rican, but he would say it so low, you know, as he walked by, just enough so you could hear, but you cannot be sure, or something like that. One of the things that the bullies do is sabotage the work that the target does. So she would hide patient charts, and the whole office would go crazy looking for the chart, and we have to work with the patient without the chart, and, you know, next day the chart would appear on my desk. So, you know, but I complained to her about her to my boss, to other supervisory personnel. I even asked for social work. I was so taking that back about the whole situation. I asked to talk to a social worker. She calls me in. She hears some of the complaints that I have. She said, well, you know, I think that you are a Latino man, and because you're a Latino man, you're not used to working with a female supervisor. That was that social worker's response to me when I went to work. So what the hell, so a Latino man? So because I'm a Latino man, you know? So it's a, you know, you can see the racism and the prejudice, you know, that comes out there, right? So I complained to her boss, etc. So I became depressed, angry at myself. It was a very humiliating situation. I was doing a lot of arguing with immediate family and friends. You know, I was lacking energies, you know, besides the fact that I had just finished a bachelor's degree, you know, I was doubting my skills, you know. And, you know, one of the signs of bullying is that, you know, you dread coming to work, mm-hmm. you know, about because of the situation. Yeah? So, all right. So, you know, and of course, I felt the need to leave. But, you know, you can't just go pick up. You have health insurance, you have clothing, you have rent. You know, I had two boys in elementary school at the time. You know, and I had started working on a master's in environmental science. You know, so I had a lot of things. So I had to stay there, you know. So anyway, the abuse went on for 3 years. You know, one summer, they made the mistake that I was looking for. They gave everyone in the office a race. They were all female, and they left me out. They did not give me a race. So that was an excuse I used. I brought a discrimination complaint with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. And based on the fact that I'm a Latino male, but the the documentation was so much, right? I hired a lawyer. The documentation was so much that eventually Mount Sinai offered me the position of chemical hygiene officer. And so I started working, inspecting and auditing labs, you know, ensuring that they were working safely, etc. Okay. So I worked there for 9 years as a chemical hygiene officer, no problem, except the proverbial, glass ceiling, you know, no promotion, no opportunities to move ahead. But it was a relaxed environment, you know, but I had to eventually move. I started working in City College. So we're gonna move it. Next slide. Next slide.
The next one, this is yes. Yeah.
Okay, so anyway, in this presentation, what I, you know, one of the, there's a few lessons that I wanna bring forward, all right? One, you have nasty, mean-spirited, vile people, you know, everywhere you go, you know, they come in all colors, ethnic groups, they speak different languages, you know, and they can be part of a labor organization, or they can be, you know, there for, you know, for justice, like environmental health clinic supposed to be for justice, environment, and workers' rights and all that stuff, you know? And management doesn't not give a hoot unless it affects their pocket. Right? So all right. Okay, there's a lot of the one thing that I learned, management justifies it, you know, is conflict between two individuals, personality issues, the target is emotional, you know, target is emotional, is that it's especially for women, all right, or Latino. You know, if you're Latino, you're a very emotional person, you know. Never mind what has happened. You know, you're supposed to take it, you know, take it lying down, right? Oh, and the Latinos have a bad temper, you know, and the target is the problem, you know. The disgruntled employee. I want to come back just real quick. You know, I had a coworker. He was twice my size, a white man, and he would get angry. I mean, he would lose his temper and get angry. And the excuse that most people would have is, you know, he had a bad day today. But I lose my temper. I get angry, which was seldom, but I do lose my temper sometimes. Then I have a Latin temper, you know, whatever the hell that means. So, and there's a, you know, a difference with, hey, the way they judge you, you know? Anyway, next slide.
Oh, true. Graciano, I can relate to that, okay, to what you said.
What's that?
That the way that they describe us is very different to the way that they will describe somebody that is not Latina or Latino.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah. So management, in the case of Mount Sinai, you like to spread rumors, you have mental problems. If you react to insult, you are emotional. If you or you have a, you know, a chip on your shoulder, a Latino temper, etc. So you can move on. Okay, beware of mobs. Mobs are there's a group of people, you know, like I said earlier, sometimes they're coerced by management, sometimes they do it voluntarily. And what happens is that they start putting pressure on the target also, you know, and they do things to work, they sabotage. If you're a supervisor, you know, they undermine your supervisory status, you know. So when I was in Mount Sinai, for example, you know, I felt I was walking on ice, you know, because anything I did that would offend one of the other allies would come back to me. Well, you know, this, you are a problem, you know, they justify that. So I was walking on ice most of the time. But I did a lot was any other bullies, the mob, I would do birthday parties for them, you know, and they would look at each other, what is this guy doing, you know? But that's the way to keep it like neutralized, you know, keep it neutral as much as you can. So next one. And so what can I do and what can you do to protect, you know, you document conversations, incidents in Mount Sinai, the thing And I also had an issue at City College. You know, I'll talk about that real quickly later on. But you document everything, every incident, anything the person says. You take notes. You have a notebook, and you take the time. You take the date. You know, that's why when I submitted the case, you know, the documentation was overwhelming. Well, nothing happened. You know, they can't come back and say nothing happened. Yeah, but you have the fucking date. You have the date and the time that it did happen, and this is what was done. You know, so anyway, so you take the time. You call the grievance counselor. We at the committee. This ad hoc committee that Lisette and I and other people are working on. One of the objectives that we have is to train the grievance counselors, because there was a point where the grievance counselor would say, well, you know, this is not in the contract. You know, well, no, hell, it's not in the contract. It's a problem. You know, you have to do something about it. And so we're trying to get the grievance counselors to be trained, okay? But you use also, you know, the college internal processes. I used to Mount Sinai, you know, I tried it. I never went to human resources. I went outside. But at City College, where I had a problem, I did go and use internal process. I went to his supervisor. I went to the vice president. I went all over there. I mean, if there was a roach somewhere, I would go to the roach. You know, listen, we have a problem here. And eventually, I took him to the diversity office, and the diversity office said, this is talking about City College now. And I said, well, you know, there's not discrimination because he's not singling you out, but all the witnesses said that this guy has a problem. And the point here is, I have been working at City College for 2 years now without a problem, okay? It doesn't mean that the bully changed. The bullies don't change it unless they go to a psychologist, because this is so ingrained in them, you know? Unless they go to a psychologist. And I'm telling you this because I've read all these articles. I read, you know, a lot of investigations that have a lot of the research that has been done, and these people don't change. They don't change. What happens is that they are under control. That's what happened. So anyway, the PSC has that anti-bullying ad hoc committee and to educate, denounce, organize, and we're trying to get someday, you know, subcommittee volunteers to address member concerns that you're being targeted. You have somebody to talk to you. You know, we're not counselors or anything like that. We're just somebody that can hear you and help you, you know, in the process, you know? So, okay. Okay, next one. So, you know, we're trying to raise consciousness in the CUNY administration. You know, the chancellor committed to a CUNY-wide committee. It hasn't happened yet. But we're pushing the union to get this, to push the chancellor to do something about it. You know, we're pushing for contract language for the next contract. And, you know, Canada has some guidelines on bullying. And Puerto Rico just adopted a law. So that makes two countries in the hemisphere, Canada and Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico, I consider a country, though it's submitted to colonial power, right? In this hemisphere to have something on bullying. So next slide. Okay, so, you know, what I advise people is a very difficult situation. You know, you try to assert your self-worth and self-value, you know. Don't let anybody knock you, you know. And bullying is part of a culture that has to be changed. And it'll be changed, you know, in a slow process, but it has to be changed. And if you're working within CUNY, you know, you must have been done many, many good things, you know, that are probably not recognized. So just bear that in mind. And, you know, if you have any issues, anybody who has issues, yeah, call us, call the grievance counselor. I think that grievance counselor already are more aware since we started this campaign that something has to be done. You can't just, because I know that Lisette has brought it up and other people, I have brought it up, you know, with the president. This thing about grievance counselor is not Jeanette, giving too much importance to bullying. The what?
That Jeanette also has brought it What's up. To see it.
Yeah. I think that the grievance counselor are much more aware that of this, that you cannot just turn people back and say, oh, I can't deal with it because it's not in the law. Oh, no, I can't deal with it because it's not in the contract. Bullshit, you know? You have to do something. Yeah, there's something has to be done, you know? So anyway, next slide. So anyway, some references. This is not the whole thing, but no asshole rule, building a civilized workplace and surviving one that isn't. It's a really interesting book. It's funny sometimes. Complete Guide to Understanding, Controlling, and Stopping Bullies and Bullying at Work. A Guide for Managers, Supervisors, and Employees. And that's a really good book also. And A Bully at Work by Gary Namy and Ruth Namy. So these are, you know, these are references of books that you need to read. I'm going to tell you something. This goes for Jacqueline and all the other people who have been targets. I did not know I was a target when I heard someone speak about this. You know, I was like, what the hell is going on? You know, and I was feeling sometimes depressed, sometimes angry, you know, sometimes I was just not sure, you know, what to do until I started hearing this. And the second time that I heard, I said, you know, I have to admit that I've been a target of bullying. And not only that, but for 9 months, I went to a therapist to work these problems out, you know. I went for 9 months because I was going, you know, I was going crazy. I thought I was going to one day get up and kill somebody or kill the bully, to be accurate. So, you know, these things, you're not alone, all right? And to know that you're being a target is liberating. You start breaking away. You keep saying that you're not afraid. You know, I'm the same way. I'm not afraid. I think that all the fears I had, you know, dissipated when the moment that I became conscious that this, you know, that this was a problem, and it's not my problem. It is, you know, it's our problem. It's that we have the responsibility, but I did not choose to be a target. You know,
exactly.
I did not choose to be a target. So anyway, that's all I have to say. Any questions? You know. Okay. Thank you.
Very powerful. You heard the presentation, but it is a testimony of his life, right? Of the experience that he went through. And share it with us and be confident to share it with all of us so we can make the changes. Change the culture. And upcoming, you know, we're gonna have more events. So keep posted, we'll keep you posted as that. But now we will go personal sharing with welcome Graciano's widow, Carmen Basquet, who by the way is another activist, one of the original leaders in the PSC, New Caucus. So Carmen, can you unmute yourself?
Yes. Hi. Can you hear me?
There you go, Carmen.
Hi.
Welcome.
Thank you. All right. So I'm just going to read what I wrote, the little something. I wanted to say that I am so happy and honored that the PSC CUNY has taken this time to celebrate my husband, Graciano Matos, and his contributions to fighting for a bullying-free workplace. I too work like CUNY, like you said. I worked for CUNY for over 20 years at three different colleges, and was a PSC CUNY union delegate for several years. So as a retiree, I am proud that the union has taken on this just cause. Being the oldest sibling in a large family, Graciano was used to caring for others from a very young age. His passion for justice showed in many ways throughout his life. He fought for the rights of students, for the rights to have a free Puerto Rico, and in the United States, for the rights of communities to clean air, good education, and housing, among many other issues. Prior to joining CUNY, Graciano was active in defending the rights of workers wherever he worked. Graciano saw and even experienced firsthand, and we saw that in the tape that we just saw, how bullying in the workplace impacted individuals. Beyond that, he understood that in addition to emotionally and professionally affecting those who are bullied, bullying in the workplace affects productivity, creativity, and morale for workers as well as for those they are serving. So although Graciano worked long days, participated in professional and personal development, read hours on hours, wrote poems and short stories, spent quality time with family and friends, continued to work in his community, it was not a surprise to me that he decided to put up the good fight to eliminate bullying from the workplace. He learned from others and his own experiences and did the research needed to ensure that when he started the fight, he had the facts to support what he dreamed of, a workplace free of bullying. I wholeheartedly thank the Anti-Bullying Committee and the PSC CUNY leadership for listening to Graciano, and most importantly, for taking action to move Graciano's dream of a bullying-free work environment forward. Graciano dedicated his life to fighting for justice, and the work that you continue to do to address this issue supports his dreams and aspirations. As long as you and others continue to build this movement, I know that Graciano is still with us. Graciano was passionate about life, about its problems, and about the joyful moments. He loved music, dancing, cooking, hiking, and laughing. We hope that remembering him today gives us added strength to continue the struggles that will lead to a more just workplace and world. Que viva la lucha por la justicia. Que viva Graciano. Long live the struggle for justice. Long live Graciano. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carmen. We send you a big hug, un abrazo. I'm part of all of us in the PSC and the Anti-Bullying Committee. We keep fighting. So now I would like to introduce Graciano's son, which is, his name is also Graciano. He works in hostels as a heel. So Graciano, unmute yourself, please.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much. I feel very honored to be here to have this. I don't know why my video's been acting weird all day. I feel very honored that you guys decided to do this event, and most importantly, to continue the struggle that that Bobby, that was, besides cancer, was like his final struggle. It's like he always was involved in different issues, like my mother had previously stated, and this was one of the passions that he had. And I remember him telling me years ago when things were first happening at City College, he would ask me questions about bullying, some of my personal experiences and things like that. I did write something small about what my father meant to me as a professional and my personal life. One of the fondest memories that I have as a kid is him picking me up above his shoulders and like kind of taking me around the house and saying, "Superman, Superman." And I just remember just feeling like that, this empowerment, like this feeling like I know I'm not Superman, but I felt like a Superman. I felt like a hero. I felt strong. I felt empowered. I remember in elementary school as a kid, him telling me about, we'll be talking about school. He says, "Your teachers are great. They're smart. He would tell me to respect them, to listen, follow the rules. And then he would very seriously tell me, but they're not fucking gods. Just like that. Very stern. They're not gods. They're not perfect. And you can question. You can question what they say, what they teach you, the history that you're learning. And so he always instilled that in me from a very young age to question everything. When I got older, about, you know, the teenage years and so forth, he would give me, you know, let's say like a lecture on a specific topic. And then he'd be like, okay, so what do you think about that? I was like, oh, okay, yeah, no, that's true. He was like, well, how do you know it's true? He's like, well, what do you mean? How do I know? You just told me. It's like, no, like, well, how do you know? Maybe I was lying to you. Maybe I just made that up. Don't just believe anything I say, like question it, do your research and find out, you know? So he always like instilled that. It was instilled respect in for family and love and to help family, to help each other. You know, certain things at work. So, you know, always look out for other people. In the presentation, it talks about him when, you know, when he was a dishwasher and things like that. He never allowed me to forget that. So whenever we would go to like a hotel or to a fancy restaurant or stuff like that, he would have a conversation with the waiter and the cooks and the people in the back. And he would, you know, he would, it was like he was personally offended if anybody was rude to one of the lower, you know, the lower level workers and stuff like that. It didn't matter, you know, the person at the hotel that opens the door and brings the luggage and stuff like that, like he would always have that camaraderie with him. And he always made sure that we never forgot that. So similar to what my mother said, like when he started, you know, because I knew about some of the stuff that was happening at work. And so when he started to make that part of his advocacy, part of like something that he was going to, that he decided he wanted to fight for, it wasn't surprising, because before he even opened one word, he was doing research. He was reading books. He was finding out the information, because one thing he wasn't going to do is just get up there and just start blabbing away about something that he didn't know about. So he made sure that he had known this information and then started to you know, share it with other people. And that's what he would do with me as well. Like, oh, do you know about this? You know about this book? Do you know about this person who did this research? So, you know, so I'm very happy, like I said, that you guys are continuing this, that we as a union should continue this struggle to, you know, advocate for respectful relationships in the workplace between colleagues, supervisors, and workers, no matter what level, whether the faculty, the janitor, the security guard, you know, that everybody has a right to live and work in a dignified environment in and out of work. And so work shouldn't be the thing that you dread so much that, you know, then causes more health issues. Because that's one thing he also made very clear, you know. I don't know if everybody knows, but, you know, he did pass from cancer, but he always attributed the stress and the some of the emotional toll. He always attributed that played a role as well, you know, that he was able to, he felt like he could fight this cancer. He fought it for 14 years. But that was a very big pain for him. So thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you, Graciano. And keep up the good work for your dad. You know, he'll live within you and your family and within our committee as well. And we never forget him. Thank you so much. I want to, right now we have Graciano's colleagues are going to be sharing. City College Professor Carol Young. Can you unmute yourself, please?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
I know Graciano after I become the chair of the chapter chair of CCMY PSC. And we usually bump into each other on the buses on the way to campus. And eventually I learned about his working environment and his case, grievance against the school. So it was unfortunate because he talked about it so often that the judgment is that his boss treat everybody equally bad. So therefore it doesn't count as a discrimination. So it was very sad to learn this fact that the working environment, particularly in some offices, that people are just so rude and so rude to everyone and people kind of working on tiptoe. So I was particularly try to kind of calm him down and also share sympathy with him. And then, but he won't stop right there. He continued to fight on. We first, after he attended the meeting workshop at PSC Central, he came back and said, "Carol, we have to do this." So he did it at the HEO's chapter meeting. And he was asking, he was always blunt asking about, you know, his needs. And he said, "How much are you going to pay for it?" I said, "Well, you know, we will pay the speaker." And so he's fine. And eventually I think Andrea paid for everything. And then, so after that, you know, he moved to the PSC Central and then pushing for resolution after resolution, because he had fought so many years at City College as a local place. But eventually, through my years working with him, he moved it to the Central. And I think the strategy was such a good thing for us to support him. But it was his battle, because he was just so devoted to his goal and try to work with the Central to get this done. I appreciate Graciano's advocacy, and also appreciate him in rounding up all the memberships. You know, he is always had this blue car, green car, whatever car, and he will just tell me, "And Carol, I won't give it to you because I want to give it to at the Central office." So he takes his credit. And I think through his life, I also get to know Carmen, because we did fundraising together for PSC election. And then he opened his house, he cooked for us. And then so at that time, I get to see his family and met everybody in the family. And so open opportunity for me to really know Graciano as a person in full. And then we did a presentation together at the CUNY Diversity Conference. And he did pretty much what he decided to tell his story, and then encourage other people to tell their stories. And once the story is told, then I think we know that something has to be done to somehow to ease this pain among all of us, okay? So I appreciate him as a colleague, and I'm so saddened to have lost him soon after the conference, yeah. And I'm on sabbatical, returning to campus without Graciano. It would be really sad for me to go back. Yeah.
Thank you, Carol. Thank you so much. Just remember, he's with you. Yes. Those memories will always be with you. Yes. And they will make you smile. Yeah. And reach out to us anytime. We're here. We have two members from the Anti-Bullying Committee that are going to share, Damien Chu, and then it's going to follow by Clara. So Amy, you go ahead.
Thank you. You're welcome. Welcome, everyone. I remember Graciano from the delegate assembly meetings. I think that's probably where I first met him, saw him, and heard him speak. And to me, he always had a great command of the room. He always spoke the truth. he had a conviction about him, and he was not willing to back down when it came to bullying. I remember him going up to the microphone, always asking, where are we with this? What's the update on the bullying? What's going on with the contract? He always wanted to know, and he always pushed the union leadership to do more. And so a few years ago, I had gathered a number of people to come together on a panel talking about workplace bullying in academia. And that's where I really learned of his story and how much it impacted him. And I was really in awe about the effects of bullying, in that it really touches everyone. It could be direct or indirect, male, female, doesn't matter what race, ethnicity, or age. It has an impact on all of us, and it affects our community at large. And it also affects how we treat each other in society. And I'm absolutely convinced that there is no amount of law or legislation that can change people's hearts. Bullying, to me, comes from your heart. And Graciano was a man who was about kindness, dignity, and respect. And he treated us like that as well. And I look back on his work on the committee, and he had a fierce determination to get it done, to work together. Even though we have very strong personalities on the committee, it was always a spirit of unity. It was the cause that made us come together and to work together, even to strive in the face of adversity, even if it meant speaking the truth that our union and CUNY and management and leadership, they didn't want to hear it. But he was not afraid to call it like it was, to speak the truth, to open our eyes and ears to what was happening, but also what we needed to do in order to change that. And a large part of that comes from changing the culture within CUNY, as well as within our union. And even to this day, as a committee, when we struggle, yes, we still do struggle. It's not roses and perfume all the time. We struggle, most certainly. And I remember an email that he had written back to our committee at the time when our committee had formed. And every time we're in that deep struggle, I always go back to this email to remind myself of the vision that he had. And I will share with you his email. And quoting from Graciano, he said, "What I thought was a good, positive action has turned into a crappy, convoluted, bureaucratic, useless discussion, which leads me to believe that there is a real need to develop, establish, and encourage another vision and another practice in our union. As time goes on, there's a clear tendency towards a very stale, bureaucratic, stagnant view of our leadership responsibilities. We think that the Roberts Rules of Order are the panacea to our problems, but the problems are much deeper. Our duties of empowering, organizing, and growing have taken a back seat. It is a sad situation that I hope we can resolve sooner rather than later. Or we will be sailing uncharted, stormy waters without the skill set needed to survive. Graciano Matos." Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. And now is Clara.
Okay, and I want to welcome everyone that we came on this very important occasion to commemorate our friend Graciano Matos. And I am deeply humbled by the request that I was invited to give a few words about him. I first met Graciano at the CUNY Diversity Conference in March 2019, where I was giving a talk on workplace bullying. My talks tend to be moving, as I'm very passionate about this important topic. And Graciano was in the audience, and I know he was as passionate as I was on workplace bullying. And we always saw eye to eye with comments and suggestions. At the CUNY Diversity Conference, he told me privately, he was touched by my presentation. And he said, after listening to my talk, he hopes that through my talk, people who are victims of bullying will have the opportunity to wake up. And I'd like to continue talking with you. I said that would be great. And he wrote me an email inviting me to talk at City College about workplace bullying in November 2019. And of course I came. And the audience were mostly HEOs, a couple of people working at the medical school. We continued working together on the PSC Anti-Bullying Committee. And we also sat on a panel aimed to discuss workplace bullying for our CLT chapter, which was organized by Amy Ju, who you just heard. Graziano was a very gracious man. He was dignified and respectful. He wanted to make a difference in the lives of those who were bullied. He told me about his prior bullying experiences before coming to CUNY, and he didn't want others to experience what he had felt. It's very hard sometimes to find a focused and committed person like Graziano. He was interested in making a positive change, and I hope we are continuing his legacy, and I'm very honored that I got to know Graziano.
Thank you, Clara. Thank you, family and friends, for sharing your experience and imparting in us Graziano's strengths and goals. And now, Lisette.
I just want to add something to what you just have all said. Just because Graziano was the way he was, I think that we have to add to everything that we have said that he would call things like they were. He will call it out, and he had that raw character. And in Spanish, we call it a calzón quitado. A calzón quitado means whenever you see it, you say it, and you tell them. And he always had that in his spirit. So I really thank Carmen and Graciano's son, Graciano Matos III, for sharing in what way bullying impacts the family. And also to share, just like Carol and Carmen, to share the other aspects of Graciano that maybe many of you didn't know, because we only see each other in our offices, but many times we don't see what happens in our homes, in what way we get engaged with other activities, in what process we participate, in what way we open our homes and we cook and we dance and we sing. And Graziano had that available also. And he had it and he shared it. So I thank all of you for saying what you just said. And I just want to invite another dear friend of Graziano. And I have this distinct pleasure because this is a very dear mentee of Graziano. I will call her like that, and she will then tell me if I'm wrong. Her name is Mariposa Maria Teresa Fernandez, and many of us know her as Mariposa. She's a CUNY faculty member, and she teaches at Lehman College in the Women and Gender Studies program and the Africana Studies department, as well as in the Black Studies program at the City College of New York. Mariposa is a recipient of the 2021 City Artist Award and the 2021 CUNY Adjunct Incubator Grant. Mariposa has served New York City as a teaching artist, and she has taught creative writing for numerous public schools and nonprofit organizations. She's an award-winning Afro-Puerto Rican poet, spoken word performance artist, visual artist, educator, activist, scholar, and Bronx native. Mariposa's work, her poetry, has been published in African American Poetry, 250 Years of Struggle and Song. It has also been published in the Norton Anthology of Latino Literature, in the Afro-Latinx Reader, History and Culture in the United States, and in the Anthology of Struggles and Protests in 21st Century USA, among others. We will put in the chat her bio. But more than anything, she's currently working on Hunts Point Stories of Strength, a multimedia project documenting stories of neighborhood and community resilience in the South Bronx. And I would like to dare to say, because I feel Graciana's spirit in me right now, that Professor Fernandez, as I should call her, is another example of a talented, creative educator and artist within our CUNY community that deserves a full-time position. And I know that she didn't ask me to say that, but I feel it. It's a call in my heart. And I wanted to say that because you should be with us for many, many years in a full-time position, Mariposa.
Gracias.
So, tonight she's here with us because Graciano meant a lot to her and she wanted to render tribute to him. So bienvenida, Mariposa.
Gracias. Se fue el presidente. He should have heard you say that.
Well, I want to say that the president of City College, President Boudreau, was here, and I was.
Yeah, he was. I was happy.
And you know what? Don't worry. This is recorded, so we will send it to him.
This is so amazing. Thank you so much, and I loved hearing Carmen and Graciano's and everyone and most importantly hearing Graciano's voice. That was so, oh my God, I loved it so much. And yeah, I'm really honored to be here. I love Graciano's training, bullying in the workplace and being a target is such a painful experience. And so common, and I too have been a target and have had this experience. And I just want to thank the PSC for putting this beautiful evening together with this theme and dedicating today, which is Graciano's birthday, which he always loved having a party. And he always loved getting people together and celebrating his birthday. So I think that it's perfect, you know, and to use his voice and his experience and his wisdom to continue to help people and to give advice. And even listening to what he said, thinking of my past experiences, it was healing to be able to have an understanding of what was happening to me at the time, because I didn't understand either until tonight that what I was a target. I mean, I felt completely victimized. I knew that it was bullying. I knew that it was wrong. I knew that I dreaded. And that so many jobs. And I think that it exists as a part of our culture, as a part of economic oppression and capitalism. And I would love to have those conversations with you all in his spirit. And he would love that, for us to have conversations about that. I don't have any poems, and as I was sitting here thinking and just remembering, like I just remembered something that I hadn't thought about in a while, because I don't have any specific poems that speak to this particular topic. I do want to just give a plug because I'm really into Jesus. I mean, Jesus Colón is amazing, and he writes a lot about, you know, labor. And, you know, I was telling Lisette that, and I was looking through to see if there was there anything appropriate that I could maybe quote from Jesus Colón. But I use, these sketches are very short, and they inspire you to, at least me, and I use it to inspire my students to write about their workplace experiences, to write about labor. And I think that it's very important that we write about our experiences with labor and those of us that have had these experiences. The only thing that I have created that's like fully formed and developed is not really appropriate for this forum, because I have a one-woman play that is centered on a character of the boss that you love to hate, where I just basically like made this conglomeration of all the assholes, to quote Graciano, of all the assholes that I worked for. And her name is Chloe, and she's the boss that you love to hate. And I create this whole one woman, you know, play to explore these issues of economic oppression, bullying, you know, exploitation. But Chloe is a dominatrix, and And Graciano came to the play. He came because I applied to a grant. I applied for the One Festival, and I won the opportunity to perform this Chloe Exotica Erotica. It was called Chloe Exotica Erotica, like I Chloe, and perform this 30-minute play. And he was just kind of like, he came to support, but I think he was kind of shocked because I do a chair dance and it's, I mean, I say vulgar things, and but it's meant to be comedy, and I think it's funny. But I thought that I would just share that just for kicks and to make you laugh. I do want to share a quote by Roberto Clemente. Anytime you have a chance to make a difference in this world and you don't, you are wasting your time on this earth. And we can all those of us who knew Graciano knew that he did not waste a single moment because he dedicated so much of his time. For you, Graciano, who gave it your all in your work and in your life, a man who stood up to the bullies and the tyrants of this world, for justice, the end of suffering, and for freedom, that you were always the one to say presente. And so we say today, and I would like for everybody to go off of, to unmute yourself. And when I say, we say Graciano Matos, we all say presente, okay? So for you, Graciano, who gave it your all, in your work and in your life, a man who stood up to the bullies and tyrants of this world, for justice, the end of suffering, and for freedom, that you were the one to always stand up and say, presente, we say,
presente,
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 presente.
I wanted also just sing a little song because the best, you know, to add to all the advice that he gave, the what he taught me and what he taught all of us, that a very important form of resistance is to really just be happy and to be joyful. And, you know, and that joy is revolutionary. To celebrate life is revolutionary. And so, as I was trying to think about, you know, there's so many songs. I can remember so many times dancing with Graciano. The only thing that really, as I was thinking all day, like what came to my mind was, viva tu, viva tu vida, viva tu vida contenta, así viviré muy bien. Porque si te apuras, te mueres, si no te apuras también. Love you.
good.
Thank you so much.
Mariposa, thank you so much for that. And I hope that as we are coming now to the personal sharings of other people, right? Jeanette, would you like to ask anybody else who would like to
sure.
anything?
Is anyone that would like to share? I know there was Cecilia, I think it was?
The person that came very early.
She wanted to share, but I don't see her.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
Identify yourself, yes.
Hi, everyone. Okay. Hi, everyone, Celia Lloyd. Hello to the Matos family. Yeah, I came in early because I lost my way, but I actually didn't. I'll say this. I've been at City College for about 23 years now, and I hadn't really met Graciano until years later, but we'd always see each other in the, you know, you come onto the campus, we see each other on the campus and you say, hi, morning, good afternoon, you know, you greet each other, because if somebody is on my campus more than 2 days and I bump into them, they're on my campus, right? So they're my family. So, this went on for years, and then sometime in, I want to say it was maybe 2012, I had, I got word that I was receiving a CUNY Productivity Award. And when I looked at the list, Graciano also was receiving an award in that year from the university. So I says, well, I don't know who he is. So let me go find this person. My colleague's getting an award. Let me go, let me congratulate them. So I had my assistant and look him up. I called him, went to find him, and I go, I know you. We've been saying hello to each other for years on campus. So we were both excited about it. I decided that I was going to drive to Queens College to receive the award. And I just pretty much told Graciano, you're riding with me. And he was like, really? You don't have to. I said, yes, we're going together. So we drove out to Queens College together, sat together, received our award. And that's really when I learned a lot about Graciano, the person, Graciano, the strength, Graciano, the gentleman, Graciano, the relentless person who didn't give up and who was really focused on fighting for the rights of persons who were marginalized and bullied. I come out of this better for having met him, because on the ride to Queens College, and lucky enough for us, the traffic was horrific going out to Queens College from CCNY, and it was equally as horrific getting back. So we got to be in that bubble in my vehicle for quite a long time, where, you know, he spoke about his family, his wife, and just, you know, I got a deep appreciation for the man that Graciano was. And then off and on, following that, off and on, we'd visit each other and say hello. As a matter of fact, there was one plaque, and he says, well, you can have it. And I go, no, you can have it first. So we kind of shared it. But in any event, I'm just honored to have met him. And just knowing that you walk past your colleagues every day on campus, or you walk past people on your campus or any place, and you don't know who they are, right? But the fact that we just knew each other because just, hi, how are you? How are you doing today? How's the weather? How's whatever? And it turned out that I'd known this man for years. So I'm, you know, that's his strength. Yes, I got a lot out of that. He became one of the favorites of my assistants. So we were like, you know, really saddened that he had left us, but he remains in my space. And that plaque is sitting in my office. So I kind of look at it every day and say, my colleague. So it's just, thank you so much for just inviting me to be here and just to honor my colleague and to honor his family as well. I'm humbled. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Anyone else would like to share? You could unmute yourself.
So
you see anybody else?
No, I don't see anybody. So I think that what we are all hoping, and Celia, thank you so much for sharing that, because when you're saying that, we understand that we are all complex people, and sadly, we don't have the time many times to get to know every single realm of everybody that works around us. So I think that I'm glad that you mentioned that. And I hope, and we all hope in our committee, that this evening has given you another insight of how much all of us need to fiercely, just like Graciano, and tirelessly fight against bullying in our workplaces. We know that it exists. We know that we have been talking about, and I think I want to echo what Graciano said at that time, every time. It is about time to do something about it. And it's not only enough to have a resolution and call it Graciano's Bullies Week or Anti-Bullies Week, or just give me a resolution on paper. Just make it real for him and for every single Graciano that is out there, because there are many of us who have been bullied And we have to stand up for the ones who are bullied, and we have to learn how to do that. And we have to ask our union to keep fighting to include that in the contract language so that we will be fully protected. So I will like now to, we would like to conclude now the evening on behalf of every single member of our anti-bullying committee with two songs. One of them is called Palante. Palante, for a word that I hope that you learned today, if you haven't learned it yet in New York, it means onward, go forward, palante, palante. And it's a Puerto Rican expression. We use it very, very often. Every time that we feel we're falling down, we're falling apart. And it's a song written by Alinda Segarra from Hoorah for the Riffraff. My daughter was the one who introduced me to it. But it includes excerpts from a very famous poem by Pedro Pietri, Puerto Rican obituary. And we are going to include the link in the chat so that you will take a look at it and read it when you have time, because it's still relevant. And after that, we're going to have another song, because just like people have said, Graciano loved to dance. And we hope that you keep the joy of living in your hearts. And especially now in CUNY, it's very tough times that we're living in our campuses. It's called Las Caras Lindas de Mi Gente Negra, The Beautiful Faces of My Black People. And it's by Ismael Rivera, a wonderful sonero. So stay tuned, don't leave until you, at least you listen the two songs, and then we can call it off for the night. It was wonderful to spend time with you, and please keep attending the following events, and we will also put that in the chat. So just let's listen to Palante and then Las Caras Lindas de Mi Gente Negra. Go and for it, Jorge.
Lise, Ismael Rivera was Papi's favorite artist.
Ah, pues vamos para allá.
Favorite.
They all died, dreaming, hating, and waiting. Dead Puerto Ricans who never knew they were Puerto Ricans, who never took a coffee break from the Ten Commandments to kill, kill, kill the landlords of their cracked skulls and communicate with their Latin souls. Juan, Miguel, Milagros, Olga, Manuel, from the nervous breakdown streets where the mice live like millionaires and the people do not live at all.
You got it?
Las caras lindas de mi gente negra son un desfile de velas en flor, que cuando pasa frente a mí se alegra de su negrura todo el corazón. Las caras lindas de mi raza prieta vienen de llanto, de pena y dolor. Son las verdades que la vida reta, pero que llevan dentro mucho amor. Somos la melaza que ríe, la melaza que llora. Somos la melaza que ama y en cada beso eso vivo orgulloso de su colorido. Somos betún amable de clara poesía. Tienen su ritmo, tienen melodía. Las caras lindas de mi gente negra.
Las caras lindas.
Qué linda, pero
las caras lindas,
mira qué lindas son.
Las caras lindas.
Tienen de llanto mucha melodía, te digo, ven, tienen belleza y también tienen poesía de la bien linda.
Las caras lindas. Esa sí que es linda. Las caras lindas. Las caras lindas. Las caras lindas de mi gente negra.
Bueno. Qué linda, qué linda, qué linda son. Negrura, la pura. Vacilón, un riquito vacilón, con tu corazón, rico de melón. Para las caritas lindas de Lloren Torres, dile Mario. Qué linda, qué linda, qué linda, qué linda, qué chula que son, bonitas que son, bien bonitas, chulitas que son, qué lindas son, caritas lindas, lindas, lindas son. Llévame. Thank you.
caras lindas. Pero qué lindo, qué lindo, qué lindas son.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Amy, Jorge, Faye, Lise, all those that share, and first of all, the Graciano family. We thank you for being here. Your dad, your mom is there, Carmen. I don't see her, but Graciano is gonna be always with us. The spirit's gonna be with us. We're gonna continue in this fight and we're not giving up. Like he did not give up. So I just wanted to share that. Thank you, all of you, for sharing. Anyone else want to share anything? We want everybody to unmute.
Thank you so much. Take good care and keep the fight on.
Gracias. Yes. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you for making your pop grandpa so happy.
Mira, princesa. Una princesita.
Nadine, I'm gonna get you.
Bye-bye, Angela. Bye-bye, Kimberly, Angelo, Cynthia. Thanks so much for coming.